مساء الخير. انا عارف انه كان يوم طويل فمش هطول عليكم. But I want to start with a story that happened almost 8 years ago. 8 years ago, I was about to join my first ever secret political meeting. Have you ever, any one of you here joined the secret political meeting before? Come on, raise your hands, you're not going to prison. Be honest. Okay, I can see a few. When you're going to such meeting, you have mixed feelings between super excitement and between a little fear. Mine was more excitement than fear. And this meeting was held to discuss university, AUC. We were back in September 2011. The university had been reporting consecutive deficits year after year after year. The tuition was increasing year after year after year. There was huge problems with how they deal with workers. There was huge problems with salary structures. And that was it. We're talking about 2011, by the way, 8 months after the 25th of Jan. And we felt that our time is now. If not now, then when? We called for a meeting, which was attended by probably at max 50 students. And we said that tomorrow, on the first day of our classes, fall 2011, we are going to hold a general strike. Everyone was excited, strike, woo-hoo, at last. And spirit was very high, and our demands were undebatable. Who would debate fair treatment to the workers, or who would rate better financial management? None. And we said, the 0 hour is going to be tomorrow at exactly 1 p.m. at the assembly. Tomorrow, the revolution is going to come to AUC. I felt like Che Guevara a little at that time. I was super excited, 21 years old, full of hope and dreams. And then while I was going home, I saw a tricycle, tuk-tuk, which was very rare to see at this street. And at the back of the tuk-tuk, there was a wisdom that I felt at the time was a message from God. It said, "Saat al-Jad ma laqitsh had." And I was, okay, I hope it's not a message. And then on the next day, I didn't even have breakfast. There's no time for breakfast. We're revolting now. We came to the university. We stood by in front of the admin building. 1 p.m., we take over. 1 p.m., the ground become ours. And then 1 p.m. came, and no one came. Not even the 50 students that were in the meeting the night before. And that was a little embarrassing, but we said, okay, no one ever comes on a time for a revolution. It's a revolution. That might be their character. They are revolting. So we waited. 1:15, no one came. 1:30, no one came. So some of us started to cry. Some of us started to go home. Some of us were discussing changing universities even, but at the time we felt, okay, we need to move. We need to start acting. And we held a march from the admin building across the universities. And we said, as happened on the 25th, people will join. When they see action, action leads to awareness and awareness leads to action. But when they see action, when they see us really moving, they will join. So we moved. And no one joined. And they were actually pointing at us and making fun of us. Why are they, who are these people? What's wrong? Why are you upset? And that was very embarrassing, and I might even go and say very traumatic, because we are then at 2011 at the peak. And our, I would say, bet was that AUC students are not apathetic. We felt that after the revolution, after bursting the bubble once and for all, apathy should be gone. But then we were shocked to realize that apathy is there, apathy is here, apathy is among us. Because the same students that refuse to join, they suffer from exact same problems. That they have the same increased tuition, they have the same reduced services, they have the same aspirations for a better quality of education. So some of us decided that, okay, let's give up. Let's not try any more time. Those people are apathetic. Those people are worthless. Those people do not deserve what we are trying to do for them. We are actually higher beings who are trying to bring them their rights. And some of us said, well, no. Why be judging? Remember how we ourselves were back before 25th of January? We were also apathetic. We were also apathetic. And I remember myself, I was a very apathetic student, and I never cared about activities, I never cared about the public opinion, and all I cared about was good grades. Because that's how I was conditioned from a very young age. I was conditioned to be apathetic. I was not born apathetic, but that's the result of years and even decades of conditioning. From starting with my family, conditioning me that I have to get good grades, starting with the university, starting with even the bigger society. We live in a society that condition you from a very young age to be thinking all the time, not in ways to fix the sinking ship, but rather on ways to jump off it, how to actually distance yourself, how to survive individually, not as a society. So we said, okay, let's actually use what we know about ourselves and try again. But this time we're not gonna have a Facebook event. This time we're not gonna just go and send BBM broadcasts. I know that's from the pharaonic age for you, but we had BBM back then, that was the high tech. But then we had one-on-one meetings. Then we approached people individually. We went to the departments, we went to the classes. It was full on, full power campaign that was stronger and more powerful and more outreaching than any of the elections that I've ever witnessed. And I was on my third year in the university at that time. And then we decided, okay, we try again. But this time, after we have engaged with people individually, this time after we have listened to them, this time after they have engaged in writing the demands, this time after they knew what we are calling for, this time after they have become aware. So on the 11th of September, and the date was very symbolic back then, on the second week of the strike, or rather the actual first one, I saw the biggest demonstration ever in my student time at AUC. I saw the exact same people that were laughing and pointing fingers, joining and chanting their hearts out. And one of those people was Omar Mohsen. Omar was a gentle giant. He was that big and that big too. And he had a very deep voice. So when he chanted, he was like, "Khafi minna Lisa." So Lisa was actually بتخاف عادي. She was really scared. And he was chanting, "Yalla Zouk, enzel min fouk." And this Zouk, by the way, was the head of security at that time. So the guy was very impressive. You watch him chanting, and even if you have no interest in the protest, you would join. Because Omar was in his final year, and he was a member of Ultras Ahlawi. So the guy knew how to steer a crowd. The guy protested as if he was in the stadium. And more specifically, الدرجة الثالثة, ثالثة شمال. He was brilliant. We loved him. And he was a force of nature. Because he chanted from his heart, everyone joined. And the guy was very impressive. And we asked, how come someone with so much passion has never joined before? What made him join now? So we asked him, one of our friends asked him, why haven't you come earlier? You would have definitely made a huge difference. And his answer was very simple. Well, you used to call for movements for the fees. I don't care about the fees. Because the reality is my father can very well pay the fees. But when I knew for the first time that there are workers here that take less than £1,000 per month, that mattered to me, because that's unfair. And then that was why I decided to join this time. So no, if you protest again for the fees, I'm not joining. But I'm joining for them, for my brothers, for those I see every day, for those who share with me the same community and are being treated unfairly. So that was also very insightful. So maybe if I had seen Omar on the previous year, I would have pointed out and said, oh, that's a very apathetic person. He doesn't move. But in reality, he was not apathetic. He simply didn't have enough reason to move. And when he had this reason, he moved and he could not be stopped. In 2011, the demonstrations continued for a whole week. And that was unprecedented back at that time. It was the longest movement. But what was very evident from the very start is that the numbers kept dropping. See, we had this imagination and this assumption that when we call for a demonstration, 100 will come today, 200 will come tomorrow, by the end of the week we'd have all of AUC. What happened is, we had 1,000 come today, we had 500 come tomorrow, and then on the last day after a week, we barely had 10, 20 students. We were very lucky that this movement was joined between the workers and between even the security staff and between some employees, so the numbers were not that low. But student participation, it dropped severely. So again, we asked ourselves, why is apathy so endemic? If they come today, why don't they come tomorrow? What's wrong? Shouldn't they come every day? And then we realized that maybe the problem was that for crowds, if you don't use them, you lose them. And we did not ask them to join a movement. We did not organize with them. We did not form a bond with them. We did not assign tasks. We did not assign roles. All we did was call for a demonstration. Come demonstrate, and then tomorrow, another demonstration, and then nothing happens. And then after tomorrow, and then nothing happens. It was eventual, and it was inevitable, that eventually they will get bored. Eventually, they will not come. And that has nothing to do with apathy. It has to do with the lack of vision. In this movement, we were very lucky that at the end of this week, we signed an agreement with the university, and I'm very proud of AUC that this was the first place in Egypt to implement and execute the minimum wage policy, long before it was implemented even briefly in Egypt. So yes, we had some gains. We didn't gain anything with regards to the tuition fees. We didn't gain anything with regards to a lot of the other demands, but we gained. And that's the nature of things. You gain some, you lose some. Because it should be a continuous struggle. It shouldn't be a one-off. It's not a knockout match. It's not a sprint. It's rather a marathon. However, we learned that day that crowds are not going to come every day. And that has nothing to do with them being apathetic. Because you yourself, if you are called to come today and tomorrow and after tomorrow, you are not going to join blindly. There needs to be a plan. There needs to be a vision. There needs to be a strategy. And there wasn't a plan and there was no strategy. So we lost the people after we win them over very briefly. We were very lucky that some of the demands were met. And things got calmer again, and then everyone went to his midterms, and we forgot about it. And then, on February 2012, Al Ahli was playing in Portside. And Omar has never missed a game, ever. On that day, Al Ahli fans, they got attacked, and it was aired on television. So we got really worried. But not on Omar, though. Omar is very big. He's a giant. He could crush them with his bare hands. No, Omar, no. We shouldn't get worried about Omar. But then on the next day, we got worried about Omar because Omar didn't show up. We were waiting at the office of the vice president, Ashraf Al-Fayy at that time. And we were all thinking that hopefully he's not injured. Hopefully he's not traumatized with the loss of his friends. And no one even dared to accommodate the mere assumption that something might have happened to him. And then a phone call came, a phone call that we were very dreaded by. It was Omar's family, and they said that they have identified his body at the morgue. So we knew at that time that Omar has died. Can you feel the silence? That's a fraction of what we felt back then. We felt the void. We felt that our brother was taken. And all of a sudden, we realized that Omar was about to graduate 2 weeks from now. That Omar is never going to graduate. That his father, Uncle Ali, is never going to see him as a graduate. He's never going to see his first job interview. He's never going to see his first child. He's never going to see him. And the voice that shook the ground beneath us is never going to be heard again. And all of a sudden, AUC moved as one homogeneous body. For the first time in my life, I witnessed the full community, whether that be workers, staff, security, students, regardless of their ideologies, regardless of their interests, regardless of their backgrounds, they moved as one. Why? Even the apathetic of them were very affected because they felt that the bubble is not safe enough. That the bubble, being apathetic, does not make you safe. Being apathetic, make you isolated. Being apathetic is a lie. So we moved, and by moved, we demanded as the full student body to have time out of academia to honor his memory, and that demand was granted. The studies were suspended for 3 days, and the mourning were officially declared at AUC and outside. We organized actually meetings with other universities. We tried to have a say at national politics back then. And it was very impressive that it takes so huge tragedy for people to finally wake up and move. But it showed that apathy can be reversed with very dear and high costs, yes, but apathy is not genetic. You are conditioned to be apathetic. You are not born apathetic. The classes were suspended at AUC, and that was very wise and very kind from the administration. It was very respectful of how we felt. But the classes were not suspended at GUC. And if you remember, GUC also had a martyr that day. His name is Karim Hussein. And when his friends wanted to organize a memorial for him, it was refused. And that was very unwise. And not only that, the university suspended three of the students. They were the heads of the student union back then, because they attempted in a not so polite way to have the memorial. So the word went out, and we knew, and we were a national front back then. We had contacts. We were friends from many universities, so we knew about Karim. We knew that the students are organizing a huge demonstration on the next day to ask for the actually reversal of the suspension of their students and the permission to have the memorial. At that time, no one thought about any organizing, no one thought about any communication, no one thought about nothing. We thought the cause is clear on its own. And that's a very bad assumption to make, because the cause is never that clear when it comes to any movement. And that's something we learned the hard way, because on the next day, we went to GUC, and in front of the gates, we were around 200 students, which is unprecedented. 200 students from other universities. And inside GUC, there was more than 1,000 students. And they were chanting from their hearts because they were damaged in their hearts. There was their colleague, their brother. So they came, and the plan was, once they come, we are going to try to open the chain at the gate. And when we enter, we are going to have a ground to negotiate with the administration to tell them, okay, we are not going to leave the university until you restate them back. The name of the plan back then was the Cinderella plan, because that was very utopian, that will never happen. And we had no other plan. We wanted the students who were unfairly expelled to be reinstated, to be re-enrolled. And on the time when we stood face to face with the GUC students, and we tried to talk to them, and we even attempted to break the small chain, just to get in, they started chanting, and they did not chant for us, they chanted against us. They were like, get out, do not come to our university, you bunch of barbaric, uneducated students, why are you here? We are here because of your colleague. We didn't ask for you to come. Why are you here? Why do you want to break this chain? Why? Why so violent? Why so uncivilized and uneducated? Some of us at that time cried because they felt, okay, as Saad Zaghloul said, مفيش أي فايدة. خلاص. We are sorry. We are sorry that we even came. We are sorry that we bothered. We're not going to come again. But then again, building on all the accumulated experience that we have from before, and building on everything that we learned, that apathy is conditioned and that apathy can be reversed, we decided to have a frank and open conversation with them at the gates. And we told them, okay, you know what? We don't want to break anything. We don't want to do anything uncivilized. On the contrary, we just need to enter. Why do we need to enter? Because if we enter, the media is going to talk about us. And when the media talk about us, the university is going to start paying attention. And when the university starts paying attention, the expelled students are going to be re-enrolled. So what do you think? Can we come in now? And all of a sudden, those who were chanting against us, those who even insulted us, they were crying their hearts out loud, let them in a very commanding, authoritative chant, let them in. And in this few seconds, the momentum was so huge, and even the security at the gates, they had nothing to do. Okay, you can come in. And we came in, and we entered. And after we entered, they had one of the longest strikes in their history in TEDxAUC, and they stayed at the university for 2 weeks. And they actually filed a lawsuit, and the judge ordered the re-enrollment of the students. And by saying the judge ordered, I just want to show you that we were not protesting unlawfully. We were not trying to do something illegal. Even the Egyptian government were in support that their expulsion was illegal. So after 2 weeks, they came in. After 2 weeks, they were re-enrolled. And that was, again, an eye-opener. So that means, again, that people are conditioned to be apathetic. However, if you talk to them, if you have a frank, heart-to-heart conversation, maybe, and I say maybe, because that doesn't always work, this apathy can be reversed. And once this apathy is reversed, then they will move. And once they move, then things will start to change. These were two of the most eye-opening experiences in my life. And I learned back then not to be judgmental. We tend to judge others. We tend to look around us and say, okay, you know these people, the Gucci corner, you know these guys, the steps, they never move. They're never going to move. But at times, you need to remind yourself that they don't move because they didn't have enough reason to move, because they didn't know what to move for, because maybe they were never approached. Maybe they also felt bad being judged. Maybe they also felt bad being stereotyped. Of course, there are always those who will not move. But that's also okay. Why do you need everyone to move? There has never been any movement in history that has been initiated and led by the majority. All movements are led by the minority. You just need few people to move. You don't need everyone to move. So what I want to say is, again and again and again, don't lose your faith in people. أقف كده كويسة ماما ولا عايزة تصوري؟ راحتك. My mother. And that's the only authority. Everything I owe you. Everything I am, I owe to you. And this is the only authority that I feel very good being apathetic and obedient to. So I want to say that apathy is a condition that can be unlearned. We can reverse the cycle. So why are you conditioned to be apathetic? Because apathy is the biggest obstacle to collective action. If you think about it, if you want to induce any political change, how can you do it? Your only power is in collective political action. Collective political action, whether that be organizing for a political party, or collective political action as it be in organizing a social movement. Both can never be done as long as people are apathetic. So apathy is very useful to power, not to you, of course, because for the power structure, as long as everyone is apathetic, no one is going to try to change it. And power never concedes power. This power can be, by the way, an administration, it can be a government, it can be a management of the company, it can be anything. So remember, every time you feel worthless, every time you feel that you are insignificant, every time you feel that nothing will ever change, that no, people changed, and some people stood, and some people demanded, and every time you go inside the university passing through Omar Mohsen Gate, remember that there were those who stood and those who tried, and it would be a shame to them to let go now. The price that had been paid is too high to forget it now. And By political action, I do not mean necessarily confrontation. I do not necessarily mean conflict, but by political action, I mean organization. I want you to realize that there is always something that can be done. Maybe the times are hard now. Maybe you feel that you are alone, but look around you. You are not alone, and you will never be alone. And there is always something to be done, even at the microscopic scale of your sphere of influence. There is something that can be done, and there is something that you can improve. I know that it can be actually very burdensome, and it can feel like a tiny bee trying to move a mighty, all-powerful elephant. But remember that if you keep stinging, maybe, just maybe, one day, the elephant might just wake up. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.